Hurricane Michael, one of the worst storms to slam Florida in a century.
Oh, awning's coming off again.
I saw an entire home taken off of its foundation and rolled down the street.
What were you thinking?
I could feel all of that history being ripped apart.
My heart is racing. We just watched that happen in real time.
It's gonna go, it's gonna go.
Mexico Beach took the brunt. That's probably ground zero.
Undescribable. It was crazy.
When they say evacuate again, pew, I'm out of here.
You're watching Surviving the Storm with your WPBF 25 First Alert weather team. Now, severe weather expert Mike Lyons.
Hurricane Michael, a rare Category 5 hurricane, made landfall right here. Can you believe all of this area was underwater? And all of the slabs you see, former homes washed away by the powerful storm. It's a tribute to Mother Nature how powerful this storm could be, at a cost of 16 people's lives and $25 billion in damage. It's a vivid reminder, we are vulnerable. I've been here a couple of days now, and it's hard to believe that Michael hit 7 months ago.
It was really sad, and I was really shocked because, I mean, it was so beautiful, and now it's barren, dead pretty much. So I was really sad.
Sad, shocking, almost unbelievable. Those were my feelings after spending some time in Mexico Beach. The first thing you notice is how desolate the town appears. Empty spaces where beautiful beach homes used to sit. Look closer, and you can see empty shells of former kitchens and bathrooms. The few homes that did survive Michael's 15-foot storm surge and 160-mile-per-hour winds, well, you can't live there. It's a stark reminder to the power of a Category 5 storm. Now take a look at this photograph, taken before Hurricane Michael. Dozens of lovely homes just a short distance from the Gulf of Mexico. Now, look at Mexico Beach today. Empty slabs where houses used to be. Before Hurricane Michael, Mexico Beach had four motels. Now, there's only one left, and this one probably won't open for another year and a half. Not many businesses are open in Mexico Beach. This roadside diner with the Mexico Beach Strong sign is one of the few. How's business here?
It's mostly workers and around 11 to 12 around lunchtime, but the rest of the day it's a little slow, but most of our business comes from lunchtime.
Still, the rebuilding and recovery of Mexico Beach is underway. You see it everywhere you go. New buildings are going up, and older structures are being renovated. Perhaps more importantly, the people here are optimistic that their beach town can recover.
We're strong, you know, and everybody over here just want to get back on track and back in life and keep doing what they're doing and keep working and make this great again.
A landfalling Category 5 hurricane, thankfully, is a rare event. It's only happened on four occasions, and three of those Cat 5s ended up here in Florida. The first back in 1935, a powerful storm that hit the Keys on Labor Day. In 1969, Hurricane Camille hit Mississippi. 27 years ago, it was Andrew slamming into Miami-Dade County. And of course, last October, Hurricane Michael making landfall right here. All four of those storms went through rapid intensification. Predicting rapid intensification remains a challenge for forecasters at the National Hurricane Center. But research is underway right now, underwater. In the warm waters of the Caribbean Sea, just a few miles offshore of Puerto Rico, scientists from NOAA's Hurricane Research Division are launching a sea glider. The first gliders hit the water 5 years ago. Just over 5 feet long, the robotic submersible will spend the next several months recording the temperature and salt levels of the ocean.
So we found that by including ocean observations in the model, you can improve the forecast by up to 50%.
Hurricanes get their energy from the warm waters of the ocean. Satellites and buoys provide forecasters with some data, but to improve intensity predictions, forecasters need more detailed information. And that's where the gliders come into play.
The heat content of the ocean. And if there's a lot of heat content, the odds that a storm will intensify is high. So you want to map those areas and see where the chances of intensification are high.
When a tropical system begins to form or move through the Caribbean, scientists will send the glider.
When a storm is coming, what we do is stop the glider in its spot, and we do shallower dives because we found that only the top couple hundred meters of the water are important for intensification. So instead of going to 1,000, we go to 500 meters. And that gives us more data points faster to put into the hurricane model to help improve the forecast. The main thing about the glider is that you can tell it where to go, and you can put it in front of a storm.
This hurricane season, more than two dozen gliders will be placed in front of hurricanes in the Western Atlantic and the Caribbean. Meanwhile, another group of scientists is trying to improve today's computer models.
We're going to be able to better pinpoint what the intensity is going to be at landfall and have more certainty as to what the range of possibilities could be.
Last September, Gus Alaka used an experimental model to predict the intensity of multiple simultaneous storms. At the time, Hurricane Florence was headed to the Carolinas, Hurricane Helene moving north in the Atlantic, and Hurricane Isaac was tracking towards the Caribbean. Forecasts from the National Hurricane Center suggested Isaac would remain a powerful hurricane. But Alaka's experimental model assesses all the environmental factors and creates what it's really like in the atmosphere. Then it takes it a step further by allowing these storms to interact with one another in high resolution.
By getting these high resolution grids not only over Isaac, but also Florence and Helene, what we did is we got a more accurate representation of the environment near Isaac, which was actually not that favorable.
It was very harsh, as a matter of fact. There was an upper level low that the other model did not depict as well. And because of that, your model suggested that Isaac would indeed fall apart. And that's exactly what happened.
That's exactly what happened, yeah. So the high shear and the dry air nearby was more accurately forecasted by this model.
It's a critical step in solving the great mystery of rapid intensification. And this year could be active again in the tropics. The forecast from Colorado State University, 13 named storms, 5 hurricanes, and 2 major storms. To get prepared, go to WPBF.com and our WPBF News app. Look for our First Alert Storm Shorts. They're only about a minute long. You can learn about everything about hurricanes, including evacuation zones, generator safety, preparing your pool, pet, boat, and putting together a hurricane kit.
Coming up on Surviving the Storm.
I always feel like Michael was, you know, looking down at all this and, you know, smiling. And
the final flight for a South Florida man who dedicated his life to hurricanes in more ways than one. The strange twist of fate as two Michaels become one. And 15 years ago, Florida was hit by two sister storms. We look back at Mother Nature's fury and explore the lessons we learned from Frances and Jean. You're watching a WPBF 25 First Alert Weather Special, Surviving the Storm.
Countless stories have been told about Michael's impact on the Panhandle, stories of loss and devastation. And today, 7 months later, the recovery, the rebuilding process is fully underway. But the story you haven't heard is about a goodbye, a tribute to a veteran scientist who dedicated his life to hurricanes. 18 hours before Hurricane Michael is expected to make landfall in Florida's Panhandle, scientists from NOAA's Hurricane Research Division are preparing for another flight into the powerful storm.
We've got, as Mike briefed, a lot going on in this flight, more so than normal. Long flight, powerful storm, a lot of things, or objectives, I should say, to execute.
The primary goal of this flight is a fact-finding mission. Facts and statistics for forecasters at the National Hurricane Center and for research. But there's something different happening, something extraordinary. Prior to takeoff, the ashes of Michael Black were brought on board by his oldest daughter, Bryn.
Who needs a kiss on there? Okay.
It will be Michael Black's last mission, a final flight for a respected scientist, friend, and father.
He was the funniest guy. he cared a lot about everything that he did and everybody around him. Inside and outside of work, he always cared about other people and wanted to help people.
Michael Black just fought for things he thought was right, both on a personal level, or I'll say personnel level, here at the Hurricane Research Division, but also on a scientific level as well.
Science is where Michael Black excelled. For over a quarter century, he was one of the leading hurricane researchers in the world, which meant he spent a lot of time inside an airplane flying through a hurricane.
He would talk about, you know, how many eyewall passes they did and this, that, and the other thing. And again, he was like a kid that was, you know, talking about playing in a football game or something. And it was, you know, he truly loved it.
He went out, as people know, over 400 times through an eye. That doesn't mean 400 flights. That means 400 times that it penetrated through the eye of a hurricane.
It was on one of those flights that Black changed the course of hurricane research history when he suggested placing a drop wind sonde, a device that measures the wind speed and barometric pressure of a hurricane, in a different part of the storm.
Hey, why don't we try this in the eye wall of a hurricane? Because we had never dropped the previous sondes in those strongest winds of the hurricane. We dropped in the periphery of the hurricane in the environment. And they said, hey, we got enough, let's try it. The rest was history.
Black's suggestion would revolutionize hurricane science, revealing for the very first time the inner structure of hurricanes.
These basically help take almost a CAT scan of the hurricanes. The results from the data we saw just in that one storm, Hurricane Guillermo, and a couple others after that, were so tremendous that it became just standard practice. The Air Force started dropping on their planes, and NOAA has been dropping them ever since.
In the summer of 2017, Michael Black suddenly died. He was just 61.
We decided to drop his ashes into the hurricane, and probably within hours of his passing.
The request was rare, but not unheard of. Michael Black certainly qualified, having made a significant contribution to hurricane research. Now, the family waited for the right moment.
And then we had this system in the Northwest Caribbean that looked like it might form. And I called the family right away. I said, you know, if this forms, it's going to be Michael. Would you be interested? It just might be a tropical storm, but it's going to be called Michael.
On November 9th of last year, Black's oldest daughter, Bryn, carried her father's ashes on board that hurricane flight. She sat in her father's chair, reminisced with his crew, and chatted with old friends. A few minutes later, it was time for Michael Black's final mission.
Today, dear father, we have ventured aboard Kermit, N42RF, and now drift above the amazing and ordered wilderness of the Gulf of Mexico in Hurricane Michael to return one of your favorite sons, Michael Black, to you.
On the third trip through the eye of Hurricane Michael, his ashes were sent into the storm as the words of the eulogy echo through the wind. When I have gone, release me. Let me go. I have so many things to see and do.
always feel like Michael was, you know, looking down at all this and, you know, smiling and honored by what we did. And of course, his research goes on and what he contributed and the impact he had on people's lives and his five kids, eventually grandkids. But I think he would have appreciated this as a very, very fitting send-off.
I couldn't be happier. I think he got what he would have wanted. I think there's no other way to say goodbye to him other than that. So it means everything, and I know it means everything to him.
Austin was married 2 days after her father's ashes were spread into the hurricane. To honor him, a small part of his blue jumpsuit that he wore so many times flying through hurricanes was sewn into her wedding dress. It became her something blue. And by sheer coincidence, the man who dropped Michael's ashes into Hurricane Michael, you guessed it, was named Michael. So we had Michael dropping Michael Black's ashes into Hurricane Michael.
Next on Surviving the Storm.
Where's your safe room?
Meteorologist Sandra Shaw walks a California family through their new home, showing them how to prepare the Florida way. Plus, it's one of your biggest complaints, how past hurricanes will help get your garbage and debris picked up faster.
On average, about 1,000 people move to Florida every day, and chances are they've never experienced a hurricane, especially one like Hurricane Michael. Meteorologist Sandra Shaw checked in with a family from California that just moved to Palm Beach County.
We're used to earthquakes and fires.
Right, so you got that covered.
We're down with earthquakes and fires, but I don't know about tornadoes and hurricanes.
Marisa and Garrett Severin and their two kids just moved to Jupiter from Southern California.
I don't know what to expect. Just lots of wind and lots of rain and I don't know. Oh.
And 2-year-old Devin and 4-year-old Logan aren't so sure about the hurricane season.
It's very scary for me.
Very scary for you?
The good news is that mom and dad have been prepping for the hurricane season.
We've been stocking up on water. We have shutters for the downstairs windows. Mm-hmm. But that's about it.
Do you know how to put the shutters on? Like if you're looking at these, do you know like what?
I've never done it, but.
They're all numbered.
If a hurricane hit here, I suppose we'd have to put all the furniture and the umbrellas and toys and different things in the garage so they don't become airborne.
And while the Severins are checking off a lot of things on their family plan, there's one important thing that is missing.
Where's your safe room? We don't know what a safe room is. Interior room of your house, no windows. Do you have one?
No.
Or a closet, maybe?
It would be this downstairs closet.
Probably this downstairs.
Underneath the stairs.
So this is the playroom.
Hey.
And it goes all the way back here.
Oh my goodness, how cool is that?
4.5-year-old stuffed animal taking a nap back there. Logan.
Oh, that is awesome. That is epic.
It's a good hiding spot, right?
Yeah.
No one can find you in hide and seek back there, I'm sure.
So what's the safe room?
It's a place that has no windows and is like the most interior of the entire house.
You go.
Checking a safe room off the list gives the family more confidence. Oh, and if they're ordered to evacuate, they have a plan for that too.
I had a friend who lived in Tampa for a long time, and she gave me a piece of advice to get one of those big Rubbermaid, you know, plastic buckets. And in each kid's room have their baby books, their passport, their social security, all those important files. So that way, if you do have to evacuate fast, that you just grab it, throw it in the car.
Hopefully it won't come to that, but this storm readiness is a new chapter of preparation necessary for those in the possible path of future hurricanes.
So let's talk about your family plan. First up, do you live in the evacuation zone? If not, then ride out the storm in your house as long as it's properly prepared. That means window protection and lots of supplies. But if you do live in the evacuation zone, don't go far. Just go inland, stay with a friend, or go to a hotel. And as a last resort, a shelter might be the best place for you. But remember, you need to bring your own supplies to the shelter.
Ahead on Surviving the Storm.
I saw an entire home taken off of its foundation and rolled down the street.
GMA's chief meteorologist, Ginger Z, takes us back into the eye wall of Hurricane Michael. You're watching Surviving the Storm with severe weather expert Mike Lyons.
Only a handful of people have felt the full onslaught of a Category 5 hurricane, and Ginger Z of Good Morning America is one of them. As Hurricane Michael headed here to Mexico Beach, Ginger and her crew set up shop here to broadcast live to the world.
I'm not standing outside because I can't, and I won't, because it is just too dangerous.
Ginger Z in Mexico Beach as Hurricane Michael makes landfall.
You have all of this water, you have all of this wind, and you can't see anything.
For Ginger, covering a hurricane was nothing new. She's been an experienced storm chaser. But it soon became apparent that Michael was no ordinary storm.
I knew how severe and how much I respect the power of water, the power of those winds, but nothing can prepare you to seeing that.
Especially a hurricane like Michael, a storm that grew stronger as it rolled ashore.
You were looking at the recon reports, I'm guessing, throughout the day. You're seeing the reports from the Hurricane Center, and the pressure just continues to drop. I mean, it dropped 20 millibars in 6 hours. I mean, it's the quintessential example of rapid intensification. And looking at the track, you know that storm's coming right at you. What were you thinking?
I was in the eye wall of a Cat 5. I think as a meteorologist, there's a part of me that says, wow, I was in the eye wall of a Cat 5, and so much of my life has been spent chasing storms and figuring out the science.
Ginger and her crew would experience that eye wall for 40 minutes.
I saw an entire home taken off of its foundation and rolled down the street.
The house across the street was gone, and so was much of Mexico Beach.
The visuals went from seeing the beach to all of a sudden I went to the other room and my producer says to me, Ginger, the ocean's in the street. And I look out and that's when I start to see the house torn from its foundation. It happened in seconds. And I'll tell you right now, it makes you shake.
I can hear it in your voice. It is just staggering.
It was well built and it was on, you know, on stilts. So it wasn't like it was in a bad place. It was just like everything else in Mexico Beach. You can't withstand the power of a 12-foot wall of water. It just doesn't happen. It's such an old, beautiful Florida beach town. And I knew I could feel that. I could feel all of that history being ripped apart. I remember seeing the roof of one of the houses just in the middle of the road. And then down a little bit farther, there was, you know, just the entire thing was full of debris. You always have survivor's guilt, no matter who you are, walking out and seeing that it was one of the only structures standing.
And now it's a Category 5 storm. I mean, big picture, what do you think now after going through that storm? It's one of only four Cat 5s ever to make landfall, and you were right in that eye wall, as you said, for about 40 minutes.
I've gotten to a place in my career and experiences, and now as a mother, where I'm thinking in a much broader perspective. I have a much wider view of the world, I think. And it really, really hit home. So Category 5 is incredibly impressive meteorologically. So hoping that we don't need to see another one in our lifetime anytime soon.
And you know that blue house that Ginger referenced during her live reports? Well, this is all that's left of it. Again, remember, she saw it washed away right in front of her. And by the way, Ginger's date with Destiny, it was somewhat accidental. She was supposed to be in Panama City, but all the hotels were full, so she ended up here in Mexico Beach witnessing a storm of a lifetime. Now, that storm was correctly predicted by the National Hurricane Center, and their track forecast accuracy continues to get better and better. Here's meteorologist Chris Martinez.
October 2016, Hurricane Matthew, packing winds of 115 miles per hour, approached the southeastern coast of Florida. The center of the storm was less than 150 miles from Miami. Ordinarily, evacuations would have been ordered for the Miami area, but forecasters at the National Hurricane Center said it was not necessary.
We could see the eye from the Miami radar, but we had no warnings because we didn't need them. We were so confident that this hurricane was going to bypass our city.
Matthew stayed offshore of Miami, came close to Palm Beach County and the Treasure Coast, then paralleled the coastline before making landfall in South Carolina. It was an almost perfect forecast from the National Hurricane Center, something that could never have been possible a quarter century ago.
The science has come so far, the modeling, we're doing a great job with the track forecast.
The improvements in track forecasting have been called one of the most remarkable achievements in meteorology. Every year, the forecasts get it right.
We spend literally hundreds of millions of dollars on these satellites and computer systems, and they're paying big dividends because we really can specify days in advance where a hurricane's gonna go. And we could not do that 30, 40, 50 years ago.
These reliable forecasts have nearly eliminated false alarms and reduced the number of people who have to evacuate before a storm, saving money and lives.
With the help of computer models and supercomputers, we've come a long way. As the accuracy increases, the cone of uncertainty gets smaller and smaller. 15 years ago, that cone of uncertainty was directly over Palm Beach County and the Treasure Coast as we dealt with sister storms, Francis and Jean. Here's a look back at 2004.
The sustained winds for this very large, powerful storm are about 145 miles an hour.
As Hurricane Francis grew, so did the intensity and emotion. The Pinewood Rush was on.
We need to you to open. We got you.
Some lumber yards locked up. Others opened their doors.
Just take my hand, please.
We appreciate it, bud.
No problem. God be with you.
Thank you so much.
Take care. Board up tight.
The roads are too packed. We can't get out now.
Hundreds of thousands waited in the calm before the storm.
We are starting to feel the first effects of Hurricane Francis.
On September 5th, 2004, in the dark of night, Francis's Category 2 winds moved onshore.
Right at the corner, there's another one of those lines down from the traffic light.
It's a dangerous situation, it's a scary situation, but we're going to get through this.
After more than 12 hours, only billions in damage remained. Francis threw boats like matchsticks, tore apart memories, and left thousands without power for weeks to come. No one knew this was only half of what Mother Nature had planned.
And here we go again, just 3 weeks after Hurricane Francis came ashore here in Florida. We are now facing Hurricane Jean.
I think it's a cruel joke.
Jean was barreling toward Florida while people were still reeling from Francis. The clock was ticking and damage was everywhere.
There's simply too much debris left from Francis to pick up before Jean hits.
I'm aggravated. I'm just tired of it, you know? Hopefully this one will lose a little strength, but it looks like it's gaining.
21 days later, September 26, 2004, Jean, a Category 2, made her grand entrance.
As we speak, there is another rain band coming through.
The waves are already coming up higher onto the shore. As you can see that it's getting kind of tough to stand out here.
Sparks were the last electricity millions would see for days, even weeks. What was spared by Francis was destroyed by Jean.
3 weeks ago, we drove out of our house to come here. We were crying, the other kind of crying, because everything was still here. It was amazing, couldn't believe it was here. Now it's all gone.
For some, tears were the only things left, leaving so many on a long, uncertain path home. What was unique about Francis and Jean, besides the fact that they hit 3 weeks apart, is that both storms hit in almost exactly the same spot. Take a look at the tracks. Both storms hit near Sewell's Point. As you heard, one of the big problems after a hurricane hits is all this debris. There's just tons of it blocking roads, preventing first responders from getting by. Meteorologist Sandra Shaw talked to the people who pick all this stuff up.
How much did you have after Irma?
Estimated around 3 million tons of material.
Was that the most ever, or was it worse like after Francis and Jean?
They each generated about the same amount of material, which is interestingly enough.
That is.
Because you would think that, you know, once you get your first haircut, then it's not gonna grow back as fast. But still, with Matthew, we had, you know, a similar haircut, but then next year comes Irma and, you know, 3 million cubic yards.
Willie Puz with the Solid Waste Authority of Palm Beach County says they've learned from the past, taking crucial notes from the aftermath of Francis and Jean in 2004.
The biggest lesson learned is to have more debris sites. You know, I think we had during Francis and Jean, we may have had 5 or 6 debris sites. Now, these past two storms, we had 8 or 9.
We really have a great system in place. It's very
fluid, and we've practiced and we've learned a lot from our mistakes in the past.
So these are our trucks, actually, and they'll back right up to the edge of the pit.
The debris is either ground up into mulch, put in the landfill, or turned into energy.
And our first priority is going to be household garbage, because that's a public health issue, and that household garbage is going to come here and be burned to generate electricity.
The first major strategy is to go through all of the roads, major state roads, county roads, little surface roads, and clear them so any emergency vehicle can get through. You have all of these contractors that want to do work, you know, and they don't want to just pick up one pile here and then drive 2 miles and pick up one pile here. They want to be as efficient as they can.
In order for your garbage to be picked up faster, it must be separated in piles, not mixed together. For example, vegetation in one, construction debris in another. And it's also best practice to do your part prior to the storm.
Have a year-round tree trimming plan. Residents started cutting all of their trees then and doing their tree trimming. And next thing you know, they have major piles out before the storm is coming. Once we're in the cone, don't cut.
Of course, the best time to prepare is now. Start trimming well in advance of a hurricane. For more tips, more information, go to our website, WPBF.com, and click on the Hurricane Guide.
Straight ahead on Surviving the Storm.
Lots of waterfowl in here, including our black swan that you can see.
Meteorologist Vanessa Vanette heads to the zoo. She reveals whether animals have a sixth sense when it comes to predicting hurricanes.
Thanks to modern technology, we know well in advance if a hurricane is about to threaten South Florida. But think 75, 100 years ago, before satellites, before computer models, all we had was Mother Nature. But animals seem to have a sixth sense when it comes to these storms. Now, is that an old wives' tale, or is there some truth to it? Meteorologist Vanessa Bennett went to the Palm Beach Zoo to find out.
Could you predict a storm is coming based on the animals' behavior?
It has been documented that some animals will get a little more nervous, kind of like your dog. They say some dogs can predict earthquakes coming just due to like the shaking of the ground that they can feel. They have higher senses, and that's how people know something else is coming.
Nancy Neal from the Palm Beach Zoo says animals are sensitive to infrasonic sounds, and since hurricanes produce their own distinctive sound waves and frequency, some animals can hear them thousands of miles away.
Not only that can they sense the changes in pressure, but they can also hear the low frequency coming off of the storm that we can't hear.
And just like people, animals seek shelter before a storm hits. Birds can feel pain at higher altitudes, which will make them fly lower. Fish, frogs, and turtles will hide under rocks and logs for protection. Sharks and dolphins will swim deeper and sense the falling pressure through their inner ears. Rabbits and small animals will take cover in underground burrows.
Hi! Hello, Tesoro!
He's upside down.
At the Palm Beach Zoo, the animals are moved to safety.
Our ultimate goal is before a storm's coming, before they can really sense bad things are happening, we want to get them into the night house.
Moving habitats can put a great deal of stress on the animals, but it's a matter of life or death.
Animals thankfully know what they should do. So if they know like an earthquake's coming, they may seek higher ground, or like a big flood's coming, they will seek higher ground.
Legend has it that just before the Great Miami Hurricane of 1926, Native Americans saw the way animals were acting, and as a result, they fled before the storm hit.
Coming up on Surviving the Storm, the powerful new way we'll be tracking hurricanes for you at home.
The WPBF 25 First Alert weather team, we take great pride in delivering South Florida's certified, most accurate forecast, something we've done now for six consecutive years. And we're all very excited about new technology that we get to share with you this upcoming rainy season and hurricane season. It is by far the most advanced storm tracking technology in all of South Florida.
The new system called Baron is new to us, but has been a mainstay in radar and severe storm tracking for decades, not only here in the United States, but around the world. We now have that remarkable technology at our fingertips.
Keeping a very close eye on this strong thunderstorm, let's get in street level.
We can now track storms not only into your city or town, but right into your neighborhood. Our high-resolution radar pinpoints the most dangerous part of the storm.
Let's take a look at our impact tracker. Again, the heaviest part of this thunderstorm is going to be right over the city of St. Lucie.
The impact tracker highlights these areas of dangerous wind or hail and tracks them down to your street. It also has the ability to identify where flooding could occur.
And at your home, strongest part of this thunderstorm just towards the west of the turnpike.
The tornado tracking abilities with this software are the most advanced in South Florida. Our new technology will help you get to your safe place with plenty of time before a tornado forms and is headed into your neighborhood.
We are becoming increasingly concerned around just to the southeast of Miami. Water temperatures blowing up, our model showing the potential for tropical development right off our coast through Monday.
And in hurricane season, we can tell you where storms are going to form before they actually develop, an exclusive feature of our new Baron technology.
It is safe to say that this new technology will set a new standard for severe storm tracking and hurricanes, helping us warn you first. We've partnered with Coast 101.3 and True Oldies 95.9 to keep you updated with forecasts of storms threatening South Florida. If a storm hits and you aren't near your TV or you lose power, you can listen to our live broadcasts on the radio.
Next on Surviving the Storm, the key reasons why the people of Mexico Beach were caught off guard, making them a deadly target for a Cat 5 hurricane.
Hurricane Michael, as we now know, was a Category 5 hurricane, and that would be a tough standard for any kind of building code. But following Hurricane Andrew back in 1992, the state of Florida adopted the toughest building codes in the country. Code tested by Francis, Jean, Wilma, Matthew, and Irma. Newer homes performed well. However, here in Mexico Beach and in the Panhandle, the building codes are different. For example, in the Palm Beaches and the Treasure Coast, new homes have to withstand winds of 175 miles per hour. But here in the Panhandle, it's only 120 miles per hour. The reason? History. Up until Michael, the Panhandle never saw such a powerful storm before. Now some extreme home builders are taking hurricane proofing to the next level. Meteorologist Brittany Ritz has more on a floating fortress off Miami Beach.
This 75-foot-long, over 4,300-square-foot floating home created by avant-garde company ARCUP is the first of its kind.
The foundation of this floating home is actually a barge with a jack-up system. So it's a hydraulic system with four legs that provide stability and enable the vessel to be lifted out of the water.
That's right. It's a waterfront mansion on the move.
The home is portable. You can bring it wherever you want. You can choose your neighbors.
So this is our master bedroom. High ceilings, open views through floor-to-ceiling windows. That's the master bath, where we have two rain showers, two vanities, lots of natural light.
The floating fortress is, for the most part, self-sustaining. It collects and filters rainwater, and it uses renewable energy.
The full roof is completely solar cells. So if you fly over with your drone, you would see complete only solar cells.
A remote can lower a hydraulic swimming platform right into the water. But the biggest selling point of this $5.9 million livable yacht are the views of your backyard. Finally, when you're ready to pull up anchor, this deck actually retracts back into the home and you're good to go.
Obviously, this is not for everyone, especially with a cost of $5.9 million. You could spend your money more wisely by buying storm shutters, checking out a new roof, or perhaps more importantly, coming up with a hurricane plan for you and your family. I've spent a couple days here in Mexico Beach, and I have to tell you, the images are stunning. They are overwhelming, especially when you consider that the hurricane hit 7 months ago. But the rebuilding and the recovery of Mexico Beach, which will take some time, is underway. Of course, folks here hope that this upcoming hurricane season is quiet, just like all of us in the Palm Beaches and the Treasure Coast. But we need to be vigilant, because Mother Nature, as we saw with Hurricane Michael last year, is often full of surprises. In Mexico Beach, I'm Mike Lyons. Let's hope it's a quiet hurricane season.